Greetings. Thanks, Onur Dogan, for asking another great question. I'm pretty sure you think you are pointing out a problem, but I'm happy to patiently explain the truth to you, brother. This is your text in yellow. You mention Hebrews 9:22. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Here, a law is mentioned. Which law is it, and who has to follow it? The word Torah literally means law. Paul the Apostle is speaking of the Torah. Remember, the Quran says that the Torah, revealed by Moses, is equal to the Quran. You are to show no distinction between the Quran and the Torah. Remember, the Quran says that the Torah, revealed by Moses, is equal with the Quran. Surah 384. Say, we believe in Allah and what has been revealed to us, and what was revealed to Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac and Jacob and the tribes, and what was given to Musa or Moses and Issa or Jesus, and to the prophets from their Lord. We do not make any distinction between any of them. And to him we do submit. Think about what that means. We do not make any distinction between any of them. The Torah is the first five books of the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. These are the Torah, the law that Moses delivered. And who has to follow it, you ask? The Jews were required to follow it, to remain within the first covenant. But that begs a question, doesn't it? If I say first, I imply a second. Where is such a second covenant mentioned by the prophets? Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, and that's capital L-O-R-D, that's Jehovah, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Jeremiah 32:40, I will make an everlasting covenant with them. I will never turn away from doing good for them, and I will put my fear in their hearts so that they will never turn away from me. Will make means in the future, so this must mean a new covenant. Luke 22:20, in the same way, after supper, he, this is speaking of Jesus, took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Jesus was the prophet, the messenger of the new covenant that Israel longed for. In Malachi 3:1, the Lord revealed this: behold, I am sending my messenger, and he will clear a way before me, and the Lord whom you are seeking will suddenly come to his temple, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Don't even get me started how this proves, irrefutably, Jesus is Jehovah God, coming to his temple. You mentioned Isaiah 53:5, but he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. Whose transgressions? Whose iniquities? Who is healed? Initially, the prophets revealed that Jesus, the Messiah, died for the transgressions of Israel. Daniel 9:26, and after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. Isaiah 53:8, by oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can recount his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. He was stricken for the transgression of my people. Yeshua, Jesus, the Messiah, was killed for the transgressions of his people. So we see the Messiah is struck down, killed, to pay for the transgression of my people, quote-unquote. Since this is God speaking through prophet Isaiah, my people likely means Israel, but it depends on two things. Number one, what exactly does my people mean? Or if it means Israel, number two, who exactly constitutes Israel? But regardless of those two points even, all nations will be blessed through Abraham and his descendants, Isaac and Jacob. Genesis 18:18. Abraham will surely become a great and powerful nation, and through him all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Acts 3:25. And you are the sons of the prophet and of the covenant God made with your fathers, when he said to Abraham, quote, through your offspring all the families of the earth will be blessed, unquote. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Whoever believes in him. It does not say whichever Jews believe in him. Part of God's mysterious plan was to bless the Gentiles as well as the Jews. Acts 9:15. Go, said the Lord. This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings, and before the people of Israel. Jesus, Yeshua, the Messiah, personally sent Paul with the message of the covenant for Gentiles. It says to carry his name. What does that mean? In Acts 4:12, salvation exists in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Philippians 2:9. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place, and gave him the name above all names, above Muhammad, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That is the message of the name of Jesus that Jesus sent Paul to preach to the Gentiles. Acts 10:43, all the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. So Jesus has completed the revelation that he died not only for the Jewish people of Israel, but for the Gentiles as well. That includes Arabs and every nation on earth, whoever receives the message of salvation that Jesus bought for you. Your next point, in the next verse it gets clearer who these people are. Isaiah 53:6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord, Jehovah, has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Do you know now who these people are? Who has gone astray like sheep? Great question, brother, and you have included another scripture about Messiah dying for the iniquities, the sins, the transgressions of Israel. Maybe you didn't realize it. And somehow your mind thinks you are laying out a proof that only Jews can be forgiven. Perhaps hoping to drive a wedge, forcing Christians away from Jesus, the Jewish Messiah. But that is not possible when someone is informed and educated in the new covenant that Jesus ratified and established with his blood. That is another reason to teach you the full, complete truth, brother. Christians need to know how to answer Muslims seeking for the truth of God's salvation. In general, the Jews are the people who turned away, time and again. They turned to their own way and even beat and killed the prophets God sent to restore them. But all people sin, brother. All people have the nature of sin and rebellion in them. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Another verse to show you who they are is Matthew 15:24. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Okay, now you know who these people are, mentioned in all these verses, the Israelites. So the true question you should ask yourself is, for whom did Jesus die? There you go, jumping to the wrong conclusion, the one that serves Islam's evil purpose. This happens, brother, because you are not seeking the truth out of an honest love for the truth. So let's look in depth at your oversimplified error with sheep and Jesus' statement about the lost sheep of Israel. First, the prophet promised in Deuteronomy 18 is promised to be sent to Israel. Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord, again that's Jehovah, your God, will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your countrymen. To him you shall listen. Deuteronomy 18:18. Now notice this is Jehovah God talking to Moses. I will raise up for them a prophet from among their countrymen, like you. So he's talking to Moses, and you means Moses. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them everything that I command him. The prophet was to come from Israel, be an Israelite, and be sent to Israel. Even if you cling to the Islamic brethren means Ishmael fraud, because some translations say brethren instead of countrymen, sent to Israel proves Muhammad was not the prophet. Muhammad never went to Israel. Muhammad never delivered a message to Israel. Muhammad never brought scriptures to Israel. Muhammad is not the prophet. Jesus is fulfilling this prophecy by declaring he is sent to Israel. And once the prophecy is filled, no one can fulfill it after him. By Jesus saying he is sent only to the lost sheep of Israel, he is establishing that he is the prophet of Deuteronomy. He is sent to Israel and was from Israel. Next, what about the sheep? Does Jesus' mention of the sheep exclude his blessing for Christians? Not in the least, for three reasons I can think of. First, and specifically on point with your misunderstanding, Jesus was sent to and only to Israel as the prophet of Deuteronomy 18. But that says nothing about being sent for the sins of the world, for all who believe. It means that Jesus, while he lived, walked only in Israel and preached only to Jews. But even then, non-Jews who came to him in faith along the way would receive miracles as well. Matthew 8:5, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came and pleaded with him, Lord, my servant lies at home, paralyzed and in terrible agony. I will go and heal him, Jesus replied. The centurion answered, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell one to go and he goes, and another to come and he comes. I tell my servant to do something and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he marveled, and said to those following him, "Truly I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west to share the banquet with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven." Matthew 15:21. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to a district of Tyre and Sidon, and a Canaanite woman from that region came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is miserably possessed by a demon." But Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came and urged him,
"Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us."
Jesus initially ignored this woman. He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." This is the scripture you rip out of context, brother. And because you do, you rob yourself of understanding God's truth to its meaning. The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. But Jesus replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." Even stopping there, Onur, you would miss the majesty of the Son of God. "Yes, Lord," she said, "even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." "O woman," Jesus answered, "your faith is great. Let it be done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Even though not a Jew, her faith appealed to Jesus, and he healed her daughter from that very hour. So I said not in the least for three reasons. The second reason is Jesus said he had other sheep. John 10:16, "And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me." That says nothing of the sheep only being Jewish or Hebrew, but it does exclude those that worship Muhammad's words, because the words of Jesus are not in the Quran. John 11:51, the high priest had just spoken. Now he did not say this on his own, but as he was high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus was going to die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but in order that he might also gather together into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. This does not speak of Hebrews, but of all the children of God. The sheep Jesus has in other folds that Jesus knows. And point three, Christians are really Jews too. Romans 2:28, "For he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but from God." Romans 11:17, "And if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them became a partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree," I've addressed your entire argument, brother. I appreciate your question and hope you now understand. Islam teaches you to think that physical circumcision joins you to the covenant God made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But Jehovah, God, your Creator, values your heart and it being circumcised. That is the way Jesus provided for you to enter into God's new covenant with Israel. Wouldn't you rather have a covenant with God who loves you? The choice is yours. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.